Just a couple of comments on, obviously we have talked a lot about the macroeconomic numbers and what we are doing on the economic front. But to put forward a couple of comments. One, with the lady, probably she has left, that probably for Pakistan right now, we are already in a debt trap and in a vicious circle. So I think debt right now has never been a great thing for us. Secondly, a few comments. I was really impressed with the few comments of Dr. Sajid Amin from SDPI, and would just like to say a couple of things that yes, the growth pattern, the way he portrayed was obviously, but there is another side to that. I personally think very shortly that Pakistan's has a three-pronged solution. Number one, that we need to fix our revenues. There is very little room on the expense side, so if we can fix our revenues, a lot can be resolved. And I agree with Dr. Saab that, yes, the saving rates really need to increase. Coming to the topic, I'll be curtailing my talk just on the human capital. Human capital these days in modern economies, as per the global economic pundits and the social scientists, is as important for a country or a region or for the world as the overall resources of the world are. Because economies are eventually created and managed by the people. It is a fundamental source of economic growth and a major difference between the developed and the developing world. It is a source of both increased productivity and technological advancement. The research says that, as I just said, that it is the main difference between the developed and the underdeveloped world. So the main problems, which are more or less five or six in nature, which are more or less universal for the less developed countries. One, as my colleague just said, that the faster increases and the huge populations of less developed countries. Then the defective patterns of investment in education and health. And, it can further be elaborated that there has been more stress on developing the buildings and equipment rather than improving the quality of education and the quality of teachers. On health, basically, it has to do more with the nutritional facilities. Again, a repetition of the discussion earlier. And again, like the doctor Saab said, there is a paradox whether we are educating our people for more job creation or for the growth of economy. So there has to be a balance, or the priorities need to be set on that. And most of all, these have been, not very consistent government policies in less developed countries, and half-hearted measures on promotion of employment and education and others. And yes, the neglect of agricultural education. Now coming back to Pakistan, or focusing on Pakistan, I'll just share a few numbers with you. On Human Development Index, this is how we are rated internationally, we have a very unfortunate and a very dismal performance. We are 134 out of 157 countries. And the pity is, since 1990 to 2016, we have just improved two places. And the main reason has been that we have been crippled, or we have never been able to have enough resources for decades to invest on education and health. On average, we have never had a budget allocation for more than 3.5 to 4% for education, general welfare, and health. And this has hardly been able to sustain our existing salaries and infrastructure. Forget about development and innovation and enhancement. So we are 134. I will just take a few more names. Afghanistan is 132, 2 points better than us. I don't know what is the comparison, but this is a fact. Nepal is 104. Egypt is 101. Iran is 71 with all the sanctions and all those things. Sri Lanka is 77 in the world. Yes, China is doing very well. So it is 47. But Bangladesh is 105. So even in this region, we are doing bad. Just, rather get than making it more technical, as per the global indicators of Human Development Index, the global average is about 11.2 years for a person in the first 18 years of the education. We in Pakistan are about 8.8. Compare it with India, it is 10.4, and the other examples that I just gave to you. 76% Pakistani youth is dropout, school dropouts. This is UNDP. So again, I think 5 minutes left. So youth bulge, we were talking about youth bulge. We have over 20 million youth. Either they are entering the market or they have already entered the market. There are no jobs available. There are no business or any other opportunity available. So I see that as a time bomb. There could be different facets to it. It could be the madrasa education. They could be totally illiterate. They could be coming through different educational systems that we have. And I'll come to this slightly later, what are the solutions and how to, go about it. But if we look at the cross-section of our educated or the overall youth, either we have highly educated or we have just the primary side. In between, the skill education, which is the topic here, is the main area where we need to really concentrate upon. There are some global leaders who have done very well in the last couple of decades, or especially in the last 6 or 7 years. We have the example of Turkey, which has really improved upon its global ranking on human capital. We can follow that, and we can also look within ourselves and with an inclusive approach and see what is happening here, what is going wrong. Again, we were talking about the expats. Yes, the 21 or 22 odd billion dollars, if they are not there, if that is reduced, what will happen to us? What I see is that, yes, CPAC could be, a major thing. The CPAC phase two, where we have to develop 9 economic zones, those will primarily be industrial zones. So if we can synchronize our agriculture sector with the industrial sector, which we missed out in the last 30 or 40 years of development and came to the services sector, it could be a major opportunity. So skill development, or the mid-tier, is the name of the game. And I personally see madrasas not as a threat, rather as a major opportunity. A major, major opportunity. Why I'm saying that? I'm saying that from my own personal experience. Other than being director of this bank, I am also chairman of a welfare organization called Al Nasser Foundation, whereby on average we are running more than 100 madrasas in northern areas of Pakistan for the last 20 years. Yes, the sample and the model is slightly different, but it has been a major success. On average, there are about 6,500 to 7,000 boys and girls studying in those madrasas, and these madrasas are English medium schools till the Asr prayer, and after that they do their Dars-e-Nizami. And I am proud to say that it has been, figures might be slightly 1,000 plus or negative. We've been able to successfully produce over 22,000 boys and girls who have entered this job market, and they are better than my own children. And I'm sure that they'll be, if not better, as competitive as your children sitting here. They're bankers, they're engineers, they're doctors, and they're social workers. And they're more productive in this economy. And that has proved one thing more, that yes, government intervention is very important, but as a society, we have a role to play. As in individuals, with all the number of experience, our influence, and our strategical thinking, and whatever we have, our own diaspora, we as an individual Pakistanis can do a lot. I'm at times overwhelmed by looking at the talent that we Pakistanis have. So wherever this is one aspect. We need to have a three-pronged strategy. Other than that, wherever we talk about youth, I try to just sit there. I'm part of Youth Economic Forum in Pakistan. I sit with Jamaat-e-Islami youth. I sit with wherever the youth comes in. One thing is universal, that they have been neglected. at all levels, and especially not the governments, as society we are to be blamed for. So last thing, that it has to be a three-pronged strategy. Agriculture is a sector which can still transform Pakistan, because although it is contributing about 20% to the GDP, but it has the potential, if we go for value addition, to increase our exports from 22 to 23 billion with another 22 to 23 billion in the next 5 years. This is the potential we have, only if I'm talking about dairy and livestock value addition. Forget about the major crops. Then 7 industrial zones and the services sector, which is almost 55-56% of the economy. We need to see what are the skills that these services sector industries need. So more or less, I'll just try to conclude here. Thank you very much.